Orlando, Florida, Pat Campbell. He's the host of the Pat Campbell Show. And from New York City, our old pal Rachel Maddow from Air America Radio. Welcome both.
Hi, Tucker.
How you doing, Tucker?
Excellent. First up, the question is America on the verge of a religious reawakening? That's what the president thinks. Yesterday, he told a group of conservative journalists that he believes this country is in the midst of a religious revival, one that is leading many Americans to see the war on terror as fundamentally a battle between good and evil. Rachel, this is exactly the kind of talk that scares the hell out of liberals. This is why people hate Bush in the first place on the left. I personally wish he wouldn't use language like this. On the other hand, let's be real, the threat that we face is not from a religious reawakening of evangelicals in this country. It's just not. And in fact, the religious impulse that Americans have has historically been a really good thing. So there's not much to be afraid of, in my view.
Well, I'm not afraid of it. I just feel like, you know, whether or not the president is the guy to trust on how fervent Americans are at the moment. I mean, he's never met a pre-screened audience in the past few years, so I don't really trust him on assessing that for the country. I think it's reasonable that he wants that to be true. I think he wants the world to be very simple. He wants it to be himself representing good and other people representing bad, evil, and he's good fighting evil. He likes simple. I understand that about him.
Well, can we agree on one half of the equation, that the people we're fighting are evil?
Well, sure. If we want to talk about who we're fighting, right now, that's a very complicated thing in the world.
How about the insurgency in Iraq? I mean, the people who blow themselves up, who kill our soldiers, they're evil, aren't they?
Well, if you talk about, in Bush's terms, who's evil, if we're fighting people who are giving sanctuary to terrorists, then why aren't we fighting Pakistan? If we're talking about people who foment Islamic extremism, why aren't we fighting Saudi Arabia? If you talk about people who aren't spreading the freedom agenda, then why is he inviting the president of Kazakhstan to go see his mommy in 2 weeks?
That's actually not... I resent the mommy comment, but other than that, I think that's actually a pretty fair point, Pat. As soon as you start framing world affairs in moral terms, as this president likes to do, you kind of screw yourself, because the truth is you have to deal with people like President Musharraf, you have to deal with President Mubarak of Egypt, you have to deal with the Saudi royal family, because they're pro-American, but they're still bad.
Well, Tucker, I had no idea. You should have told me I was going to be on with a warmonger like Rachel here. Hold on a minute. Let's talk about the third awakening that Bush brought up. I'm not buying for a minute. There was a brief third awakening. We saw it right after September 11th, 2001. I remember seeing it firsthand. Churches, synagogues were filled for about 4 or 6 weeks.
Right.
After that, the crowds dissipated. So if there was a third awakening, it was very short-lived. We're back to being the hedonistic, self-centered society that we love.
Right. Okay. But isn't it... in some ways dangerous? I don't think evangelicals pose a danger to our country. Actually, I think by and large they make our country better. But I do think there really is a problem with framing our foreign policy in moral terms, because again, it is really morally muddy out there. I do think that we are morally superior to other countries in the world and that we ought to behave that way, but we still have to make friendships. We have to sit down and eat dinner with pretty bad people. I mean,
You can whip people into a frenzy by saying we're good and we're fighting evil, and that's a way to try to rally people around something, but it doesn't make sense if it indicates that you don't really understand what enemy we're fighting. Right now, Bush has come up with about 25 different definitions of who it is that we're fighting in the war on terror. The National Strategy on Combating Terrorism that came out last week had about 7 different definitions for who we're fighting.
You have to
understand who we're fighting in order to figure out how to fight them.
I agree. I totally agree with that, and you have to understand why they hate us, something that we've taken about 8 minutes to think about since 9/11, and we ought to be really obsessing on, because it's really important. However, I notice that the left doesn't like to say that America is morally superior to other countries, and that's why I think Democrats have a lot of trouble getting elected, because they can't clearly, in simple language, say, you know what, we're better than them. They don't like to say that.
Well, I mean, whether or not we're better than them, we still
are better than them.
But Tucker, regardless of whether or not we're better than them, even if you set aside that argument, you still have to figure out how we're going to fight, what our strategy is, how we're going to advance our morally wonderful or morally stupid agenda. Whatever it is, we've got to be smart about what we're doing. And right now, I'm much more in opposition to stupidity than I am to good at than the idea that we're good and somebody else is evil.
Yeah, well, we're still, you know, but I think you have to start with understanding the truth, which is, I'm sorry, we are morally superior to Luxembourg. We just are, not even to mention Burkina Faso. Next up, Dick Cheney, speaking of good and bad, is he ruining America? That's the opinion of one New York Times columnist, you guessed it, Maureen Dowd. She says in a column, quote, Dick Cheney may be so deep in denial he doesn't even know he's ruining America. He needs a symbolic moral superwash. Pat, you think he needs a moral superwash? And what the hell is that anyway?
I'm glad that we've got Dick Cheney as the vice president. Thank God we don't have somebody like Walter Mondale or, God forbid, Dan Quayle. I want somebody that's up for the job, somebody that's ready to step in that position should anything bad happen to the president. I got to tell you what, I was really proud of Dick Cheney when I saw him on Meet the Press with Tim Russert this past weekend. He didn't do what I know people like Rachel would love him to do, is back down, second guess himself. He said having to do it all over again, even knowing what we know now, we did the right thing. The world is a safer place now that Saddam Hussein is no longer in control.
Well, I thought he got his butt handed to him on Meet the Press. I thought he was defending essentially an indefensible proposition. But he did, I guess, a stylish job considering that it's impossible. But, Rachel, I don't understand why Dick Cheney has always been the focus of all this hatred from the left. I mean, the guy is the vice president, after all. I mean, he isn't running the show. I mean, that's just a fact. He's not. Why do people hate him much more than Bush, even?
Well, I think that Dick Cheney gets more credit than he deserves. I mean, there isn't very much that Dick Cheney has ever worked on in his life that he's done very well. I mean, even just as CEO of Halliburton, he made some very, very bad business decisions. He's the guy who bought that whole other company into Halliburton right before it had the big asbestos liability. I mean, I think he gets more credit
than
he deserves.
Wait, so the greed of ambulance-chasing asbestos lawyers is Dick Cheney's fault? That's what you're saying?
No, but it was a dumb decision to make as a CEO. I mean, listen, the problem with Dick Cheney on Meet the Press is that he said not only would he do it all over again with Iraq, but he wouldn't change a thing. Really, if you could do it all over again, would wait another 18 months after sending soldiers into battle before giving them full body armor. You really wouldn't secure the ammo dump at Al-Qaqa. You really would do Abu Ghraib all over again. There's nothing that you would change. He's still maintaining that there was a relationship between Al-Qaeda and Saddam. When he was... Russert confronted him with the fact that the Senate Intelligence Committee proved that otherwise. He said, oh, I haven't read the report. That's not a tough guy. That's a dumb guy. And that's why I don't want him as vice president. I don't think he gets way too much credit.
Because here's an interesting question. The other day, Benjamin Netanyahu, Bibi Netanyahu, former prime minister of Israel, now leader of the opposition in Israel, Likud leader, said this about the president of Iran, Mahmoud Ahmadinejad. He said, quote, Hitler was defeated because he could not develop weapons of mass destruction. Iran stands close to developing nuclear weapons. Does the world understand? In other words, Iran is more dangerous than Nazi Germany. This is the position of a man who could someday, who knows, soon maybe, become the prime minister of Israel. Let's take off both your partisan hats. Rachel, you first. What does this mean exactly? Do you buy that, and do you think this is going to influence our behavior in America?
I think that if we didn't have World War II, to use as an analogy, we'd be struck dumb in politics around the globe.
That's actually a great
point. You know
what?
There's a lot of bad people in the world who aren't Hitler, if we need an analogy.
Yes, exactly.
It really shuts down all debate. And if we stop putting ourselves in Churchill suits and our enemies in Hitler suits, we could actually see what's going on more clearly in the world. Ahmadinejad wants attention, and he wants Iran to seem more important than it is. The fact that he may be close to acquiring nuclear weapons, frankly, earns him that attention. And the United States or Israel or anybody's attempt to try to make him into something that he isn't doesn't help.
What do you think of that, Pat?
Well, here's the problem, and Rachel's got a rather simplistic approach to Iran's leader right now. This guy is probably the greatest single threat to Western civilization in my lifetime. He not only wants to kill Jews, he has publicly said he wants to wipe Israel off the face of the earth. I can't think of anyone more dangerous. And again, I'm so glad that we are where we are militarily in Iraq, in Afghanistan, so that if need be, we can react to this crazy.
Pat, let me ask you something, though. When Israel was trying to work up, they're trying to work up some sort of international force to go into southern Lebanon after the Lebanese-Israel conflict. Israel said,
Israel wasn't trying to work that out.
No, the
United Nations was
trying to work it out. But Israel put a condition on it. They said, we don't want any nation to send troops if that nation does not recognize the state of Israel. That left it basically to us in Palau to produce the troops to be in southern Lebanon. It is a mainstream position in the Islamic world right now to be for the destruction of Israel. That has become mainstream because moderate Islam has been completely wiped off the map by the polarization that's happened in our great war on terror. If you want Israel to be stronger,
no,
you need
I'm
to
sorry,
support
Rachel,
moderate
Islam.
Wait,
let me jump
Rachel,
in. Hold on. Let me jump in right there. What you just said is factually incorrect. The position of the Arab world has been that Israel does not have a right to exist since 1948 in the UN partition. So it's not Bush's
it's not
fault that the Arabs hate Israel. That's just not true.
But the forces of moderation in Islam right now, the forces of moderation that say not Hamas, not Hezbollah, not the Iranian regime, those forces have been marginalized in the Arab world right now.
Rachel, where are those forces? Because I haven't seen them.
Well, I mean, what's happening right now with Egypt, right? What's happening right now? What's happening now with the moderate forces in Iran that were in power until Ahmadinejad took power
just last
year?
What moderate forces in Iran?
You wouldn't prefer Khatami to be in power than Ahmadinejad? Come on!
It doesn't matter what I prefer. We've got to deal with who's there right now,
That guy's crazy. That guy's
crazy.
That guy's only been there for a year.
Okay, now we're name-calling. Calling the Iranians crazy, that's just wrong and mean. But I want to thank you both, neither of whom is wrong or mean. Thank you very much.
Good luck tonight, Tucker.
Yeah, good
Thanks.
Luck tonight,
I'm going to need it, please.
You do. We're pulling for you.
Say a prayer. Well, Deborah Lefebvre speaking.